Welcome to Jersey Guy Sports, your sports talk home for the Yanks, the Giants, the Rangers, and the Rutgers Charlotte Knights. And I'm your host, Don. I want to thank you for listening. Now, today I'm going to be talking about the New York Giants competing but losing in crushing fashion, unfortunately, 14-9 to Buffalo Sunday night. So let's go ahead and get started. On a night in Buffalo where the Giants showed really quite a bit of fire, a bit of fight, some pep, they ultimately could not get the ball into the end zone again, unfortunately. And as a result, the Giants lost the Bills 14-9 Sunday night in Buffalo. The Giants were on the Bills' one-yard line at the end of the game. And Tyrod Taylor's pass to Darren Waller was tipped away and incomplete as the clock expired. And the Giants moved to 1-5 on the season. And it was a night where the Giants' defense played their asses off. The Giants just could not do enough on offense, again, to pull off the huge upset. A mind-boggling play call. I don't know what else you call it, but a mind-boggling, ridiculous play call on the last play of the first half certainly contributed to this mess of an offense. And it really, you can add it right there with the rest of the Giants' year-long offensive incompetence. The Giants' offense actually hasn't scored an offensive touchdown since week three, right? So games 4, 5, and 6, the Giants offense has not reached the end zone, right? I mean, it's just almost unfathomable in today's NFL that a team could go 3 weeks and not get to the end zone. It just does not seem possible. Even so, you know, with Daniel Jones sidelined with some kind of weird, mysterious neck injury thing. It was so weird. Tyrod Taylor started for the Giants. Tyrod Taylor's the Giants' backup, and Taylor did a very good job, I have to say. And honestly, if not for that insane play at the end of the first half, I'd have nothing but positives to say about Tyrod Taylor. Taylor played with confidence behind an offensive line that's generally a disaster and had even more injuries on Sunday. I think Taylor did really, really a fine job feeling the pocket, moving in space, making plays. He definitely looked like he had a feel for the game, which is one of my biggest, biggest complaints about Daniel Jones. The thing in my mind about Jones, I say and think all the time, is he can't feel pressure. And then once he gets pressure, his eyes don't go downfield. He just sort of tucks and runs or looks around or possibly looks for a tiny little dump off play, whereas you could really see Taylor moving with the pressure, keeping his eyes downfield and making plays under pressure. I thought Taylor really, really did a good job of commanding this offense, playing with confidence and doing a lot of the little things that you need a quarterback to do that our $40 million a year guy Jones just doesn't seem to do. Anyway, Taylor made good throws on the run as well, by the way. He took off when he needed to. He played very, very well. He made some really big third and even a huge fourth down conversion to keep some drives alive. And let's face it, he thrived under pressure from what is the number one sack team in the NFL in the Buffalo Bills, right? The Bills lead the NFL in sacks, and they did get three against us, but I think Taylor did a really, really fine job. I think we have one of the better backup quarterbacks in the league, really. Here's what was immediately obvious to me in comparison to Daniel Jones. Certainly pocket presence is a big deal. He felt pressure like a normal quarterback should feel pressure, right? And, you know, like Daniel Jones does not. When there was pressure, he's able to keep his eyes downfield, as I mentioned a minute ago, not tuck the ball too soon. Jones does that all the time. Taylor was pretty accurate most of the game, and Taylor really, really had a feel for the game. I was happy with his play. The Giants' offense at least looked somewhat functional at a minimum. Again, they didn't get in the end zone, so you can't call it good, but they definitely looked functional. It goes to show you that certain quarterbacks, many quarterbacks, can look okay with a terrible offensive line. You know what? There's a lot of teams in the league with bad offensive lines, right? The Giants have probably the worst of the worst, but there's a lot of teams playing week after week after week with bad offensive lines, and somehow their offense doesn't look this incompetent as the Giants have all year, and you get to see why. If Taylor had played all year instead of Jones, and there's no way that should have happened. But if he did, you know, I don't think we would have won any more games. But I guarantee you the offense would look a little more competent than it's looked. And you could tell from facing a tough Bills defense on the road in a tough environment in prime time, he handled himself pretty damn well. And it's unfortunate the way it is with the Giants right now. You know, it's hard if, and you don't know the offensive line. It's very hard to clearly assess quarterbacks with such a terrible offensive line. But here is a great comparison, right? It's the same offensive line or worse, and yet the offense looked much better with a different quarterback. And no, it had absolutely nothing to do with Saquon Barkley, who continues to drive me nuts. I'm not going to spend much air on Barkley again, but, you know, when there's giant holes and he runs for 15 or 25 yards, the announcers love it. When, you know, he stutter steps in the backfield, doesn't barely get back to line of scrimmage, spins and loses 2 yards. He's continuing to do his ridiculous Barkley shake and bake, lose 2 yards instead of put your head down and gain 2 yards. And it continues to drive me nuts. I want him gone. He's worth so much more in a trade than he is for, you know, the Giants on this team. Now, the big play of the game, I need to talk about it. The Giants offense, I said, looks somewhat functional on a minimum. And let's face it, the Giants probably should have had 2 more TDs, one at the end of the first half and one at the end of the game if it went well. Now, the end of the first half was just, you want to pull your hair out play. The Giants had the ball at the Bills' 1-yard line. There was 14 seconds left when the clock stopped. And critically, the Giants had no timeouts left. No timeouts, right? 14 seconds. So you cannot get stopped inbounds, right? For some mind-boggling reason, it appears that Tyrod Taylor audible to a running play. And I can't even possibly imagine why that was. Sure enough, Barkley was stopped, didn't get in the end zone. The clock expired before the Giants could spike the ball, and the half ended. And the Giants, who were on the 1-yard line, did not get a field goal, did not get a touchdown. How in the world a passing play was not run on that play is just, it's not even fathomable. It was one of the more mind-boggling, insane gaffes that you'll ever see in football. I mean, it's right up there. Rutgers fans might remember this, with Art Sikowski spiking the ball on 4th down. Rutgers was trying to come back years ago. It was 4th down, and he probably thought it was 30. He spiked the ball and ended the game for Rutgers. This play is right up there with that. How you run the ball when you have no timeouts and 14 seconds left on the 1-yard line. It's unthinkable that Tyrod Taylor audible to that. If he did, it's looking like he did. It's also quite unthinkable, by the way, that the play from the sideline included a running play to audible to, right? You have to blame the coaches on this as well. How do you send in a play to audible to that's a running play when you have no timeouts? You can't. This is as much on the coaching as it is on Tyrod Taylor. But no matter how you slice and dice it, this is just a play that possibly, it can't possibly happen. It can't happen. The whole play itself is one you can't even imagine as a fan. Anyway, it really put a damper on what was a good first half for the Giants, both defensively and offensively. The Giants, I mentioned, had a patchwork offensive line. It included Justin Pugh, who, when they announced the offensive lineman, you know, Alabama here, he announced himself as off the couch, right? Because he basically was on his couch a week ago, not even on the practice squad, anything. He ended up playing left guard, and then after a few snaps, had to move over to left tackle when Josh Zudu went down. And by the way, that's no big loss for the Giants. Zudu's a terrible lineman. So we had someone who wasn't even playing last week anywhere at left tackle for us, which is the most important offensive line position, Justin Pugh. And he did okay. Not bad. The offensive line in general played a competent game, allowing, you know, quote unquote, only 3 sacks. But seriously, if you watch the game, it, you know, you could tell what I'm saying, basically. If you didn't watch the game and you read the stat line, you'd say, ah, another shit game. Their stats weren't good. They gave up 3 more sacks. But if you watched it, it was better in a lot of ways. The Giants had holes to run in. They did competently pass protect sometimes. And I think a lot of that, again, had to do with the quarterback. The same offensive line protecting exactly the same way with Jones in there, I don't know if you'd say it would go as well. Because Tyrod Taylor read what was available, got it out on time, ran through holes when needed. you know, kept his eyes downfield when there was a little pressure, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The combination of a little better offensive line play and having a different quarterback really looked like an improved offense, even if they never did get to the end zone. Saquon Barkley was back to his normal self, as I mentioned a few minutes ago. Had a few good runs, lots of this hesitating, stopping, gaining less yards than he should. I'm not going to dwell on this. The Giants defense, though, the defense deserved better. For the first time this year, the Giants defense played well, and they played really well. But I do want to reiterate, for the first time this year. I had a podcast a few back where I talked about folks in the press only looking at the worst thing and not looking at anything else, right? There's been legitimate blame on the Giants offense here. You know what? Because they stink to high heaven. The Giants offense stinks. They should get every piece of blame you could possibly imagine. But the Giants defense has also been terrible this year. They're just less terrible than the Giants offense. So the defense has gone unnoticed by the press, miraculously. In any case, not this game. This game, the Giants defense was excellent, excellent. They held Josh Allen to only 165 yards passing, believe it or not. They pressured Allen almost all night. They picked off a pass. They were pretty decent against the run, although there were spurts when, you know, the Bills ran the ball okay. Let's face it, the Bills are the Bills, man. They're a really friggin' good team. Josh Allen's a superstar. What are you going to do, right? But the defense on one night finally played really, really well. There isn't anything I could say against the defense. They were outstanding. They played with fight. They were literally fighting on the field a few times, but they played with metaphorical fight too. You could see it, right? They were fired up. You know, they were in the backfield on big plays. They stopped the Bills when they needed to. Finally, again, this is the only game this year it's happened, guys. So you cannot come out of this game saying all year it's only been the Giants offense. That is not the case. All year, it's also been a terrible Giants defense, except for this Sunday night game. So just take perspective, guys. The defense for the Giants is not good. It was excellent, excellent on Sunday night. That was as good a defensive performance as we've seen from the Giants in years. That was excellent. But, you know, at the end of the day, the Giants couldn't get in the end zone. And what are you going to say? It's hard to imagine an offensive team in the NFL not hitting the end zone three consecutive weeks, but that's where we are. The Giants are 1-5. They're certainly not a playoff team this year, let's face it. If they can properly tank, you know, maybe we can get a quarterback, Caleb Williams or something, you know, who actually has the traits I described earlier, you know, keeps his head up when there's pressure, you know, moves in the pocket a little bit, you know. In any case, we're going to have to see. More likely, we'll win some meaningless game, you know, like this upcoming one with Washington, end up with, you know, overall pick number 8 instead of pick number 1. And, you know, we'll miss out on actually getting a good quarterback. It's really hard to know how to feel after this game, I have to say. Overall, it's, you know, you have a feeling in your mind like, finally, there's something you could hang your hat on. The defense played great. We actually had a, you know, still incompetent, but at least a functional offense, you know, one that could move the ball. So you're happy with that. You came within 1 yard of getting a tremendous upset on the road in Buffalo. So you're happy with that. But at the same time, a loss is a loss is a loss. And I am the biggest proponent of the famous Bill Parcells saying, you are what your record says you are. The Giants are 1-5. It doesn't matter how. They're 1-5. The defense played great for the first time all year. We showed that we have a real viable backup quarterback, one that will never play, you know, as long as our $40 million a year bust, Daniel Jones, is healthy. Next week, the Giants play Washington, you know, in a battle for last place in the NFC East. And we'll see where we go from here. This one was really a tough loss to take, I guess, in a year of very tough games for the Giants. At least you'd like to see some competitive games like this where you can, you know, have some things to hang your hat on. And for this game, the Giants could hang their hats on defense. They could hang their hats on an offense that could move the ball. They can hang their hats on the fact that they have a viable backup quarterback that can actually do some things. And unfortunately, it was another game where they just could not get in the end zone. 2 times stopped at the 1 yard line for various reasons at the end of both halves cost them a loss in dramatic fashion in Buffalo. And that's it. That's all I have for you today, guys. I want to thank you for listening to Jersey Guy Sports. Please subscribe to the podcast. Tell your friends all about it. I'll be back soon with some more sports talk. Thanks. Have a good night.